Hello, everybody. Welcome to the discussion on time travel. It's the last of the talks with Beyond Entropy here at the AA. We're joined this evening by Shin Egashira and Andrew Jaffe, the team behind the time machine prototype exploring mechanical energy for Beyond Entropy, and Goswin Schwendinger. I'm sure that Shin and Goswin will hardly need any introduction to many of you here. I'm sure, as you all know, Shin has been at the AA for some time, he's Unit Master of Diploma 11, and founder and organiser of the Koshikura Landscape Workshop. Goswin, as well, has taught here for many years. He became an architect in Switzerland and went to Spain to learn photography, and he's recently collaborated with Paul McCartney. On the table on the publication. Okay, the format for this evening is the three of them are going to be asking each other questions on the topic of time and time travel. I know they've got some very interesting ideas that they want to share with you all. So, thank you. If Shin would like to ask the first question.
If you think we are really organized something, that's completely wrong. So what we did is prepare some questions and some objects about our course. So I think in relationship to time, I thought maybe light would be quite interesting something.
We can't hear you at all.
Okay, sorry. If the size of the universe is around 150 billion light years in diameter, and its age is about 13.7 billion light years, has the universe expanded at average speed of 10 light years in the past 13.7 billion light years? And how can possibly detect light that is moving away at the speed of light faster than the speed of light?
Okay, obviously you all know the answer, so I'll just let somebody from the audience think. I think the problem here is several questions of definition. So the universe is indeed about 14 billion years old. And roughly speaking, that means that life has had about 14 billion years to get from wherever it started, which is everywhere, but some of that light happens to start in just the place where it would get to us more or less now. And that distance, it turns out, isn't 130 billion light years away, and it's not 13.7 billion light years away either. It's more like 30 billion light years away. And that is indeed, as Shin said, because the universe has been expanding the whole time since the beginning of time, as far as we know. And if you ask exactly how far away that light would have been right after the universe started expanding to get to us now, then the answer is something like 20 or 30 billion light years. We don't know all the details, so we can't say for absolutely sure. Probably what people mean when they say the universe is something like 130 billion light years in size, that's probably a sort of conservative statement about how far away you have to go before it's even remotely plausible that the laws of physics could change really, really radically. Right? So we live in a kind of part of the universe where everything around us seems to fulfill the same laws of physics that we see around, you know, Newtonian mechanics and general relativity and quantum mechanics. And it's possible that things get sort of really, really weird when you go very, very far away. Still following those rules, but following them with different numbers involved. And kind of plausibility says that, well, it can't change rapidly right after the 13.7 that we see. It has to change sort of slowly after that. So I think that's where the 100 billion light years come from.
I just realised that I actually forgot to do my introduction for Andrew Jaffe here, so I'm going to do that now. He teaches an undergraduate course in Cosmologist Imperial. He's involved in the analysis of data from various experiments observing the cosmic microwave background, the data which encodes the state of the universe about 100 thousand years after the Big Bang. He's on teams for the EVEX and polar bear cosmic microwave background experiments and co-investigator on ESA's planets and their satellites. Would you like to ask the next question?
Okay. So I'll ask Goswin. So I went and looked at some of your work. It's very, very lovely. And I won't ask you about Vincent Gallo, like I said I wouldn't. But instead, I noticed that a lot of your cityscapes that I've seen, there are pictures that sort of seem to me anyway to make it a very explicit attempt to juxtapose different times. So there are some aspects that clearly place it in 2010 or whatever London. But in some occasions there seem to be bits in it that are people or just things that harken back to clearly sort of an older time. Is that a conscious effort, or is that just because the world is actually like that?
It's a question that of appearance that I really never asked myself so much. If you see the world as something that happens at all times, in time, and you see the time as a flow like a river, and you start to observe this, you become an observer, and if you use an instrument for that, you can use the camera to freeze time for a moment. The result is the photograph, which tells the story of a moment, of a stopped time frame, that also has a time span, like the shutter speed of the camera, which reflects the time span. That is another legible, in some cases legible, part of the photograph. But the actual experiencing of or observing of a photographic moment is a very subjective one. As a photographer, you look through the viewfinder, and only you look through the viewfinder. You don't see, and you can only take one picture. And you could only take one picture of the same thing, but it's always a different picture. So every picture that is taken in the world is a different one. All pictures that have been taken since the beginning of photography, and I don't know how many tens of millions are taken each day, are all different. So the result of the photo, the result in the photograph is very directly linked to the view and the position, also the mental position of the observer, in that sense, to me. Does
anybody want to add anything?
I happen to know that there are about 2.5 billion photos uploaded every day in Facebook.
Only in Facebook,
so I don't know how many pictures are taken every single day. So how do you know that picture you are taking is, do you see that as a part of 2.5 billion picture a day photographs being taken collectively?
I think, what is your question?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I happen to know these things, but so I thought I maybe have to mention this one. But because I know the way you take pictures, you really carefully set up scenes and measuring the light and construct. It must be very, very different from photographic phenomena, which are all those information being taken in. Either maybe disappeared somewhere every day. So when you say you're going to register some history of time, then do you feel that there is a multiple sense of time you coordinate in order to register into one motion, photograph. Or those reading is actually came from the reading of the photograph. To analyze, because some chakrasa shows, right? Somehow, the reason I was saying is that Anju, the Planck satellite, is actually you are observing the light, which is 13.7 billion light years old. Registering it, try to make a map. So, which means there is an amazing sense of history. Also, you mentioned once that all light moves in all possible directions, but we only see the ones that are coming towards us. And we didn't do anything interesting. So there is very, very interesting light. You must, and there's uninteresting one interacted with one another. So that sense of the time. So when you take photograph, then there is a distance on the sun lights possibly billion light years old. Some lights which are more immediate. So would that help to be answering your question? I'm not doing this by joke.
No. I think it's I do something that Andrew hasn't seen of my website since it has been updated since 2001. I'm doing a series of night photography, completely void of human presence, often also depicting the night sky, be it with cloud or without. But then in that photo I collect not only available light that is around at the site, like street lights or terrestrial light, but also light from the stars or from the moon that helps me often to see something at night, which is from different times. That's what you are trying to say. And the result is something that is compressed onto one sheet of paper if you print it in the I prefer to still work analog as a, for my own work as a means to have a, actual physical evidence of my undertakings. So the flatness of a two-dimensional sheet of paper that has, even though it has like a surface quality to it, is comprising not only like spatial dimensions, but also time dimensions.
Would you like to ask a question?
Yes. To I'm sure which one is best to ask. Dear Shin, your email address reads shin4d@globalnet.co.uk. Does this imply you believe in the existence of space and time in a Newtonian way, as in vectors? And how do you think of altering these vectors to allow for space-time manipulations?
Wow.
Can you answer?
Definitely to you.
I mean, it's, I think I still live in Newtonian world. Maybe that is also with my failure of learning physics beyond Newtonian. Yeah, so I still try to imaginary set of relationship between objects are governed by gravity. So in a way I tend to understand things by photograph, but try to consolidate set of relationship. That's the starting point. So I tend to, rather than see things fast, I tend to try to make things slower. I try to grow up small things bigger than necessary to understand those proportional relationships, which in a way is quite new. And answer to 4D. Yeah. 4D is nothing related to fourth dimension. Yeah, it's about the dog and disciplines and direct. There's lots of D words. So I thought it'd be nice to remember those important 4Ds as a name. So that's how it's related. But you can read it as a fourth dimension as well. So, but I think there is still really amazing things about the Newtonian world, which I still can't understand it. So that's why I was asking about relative things when the universe is expanding faster than the speed of light. Then how you could detect that the light is moving faster than its speed of light. But I think Andrew explained it more to us, so I think I understand.
Perhaps Andrew would like to add something on that topic now.
Well, so, brief discussion of relativity. I'm sure we'll bore everyone. So, when the particular example that they gave me, which is a little macabre when I think about it, is I guess they're both motorcycle riders, and if they're riding the motorcycle towards one another at 100 kilometers an hour, then as far as they're concerned, their relative speed is 200 kilometers per hour, which would be bad to hit each other at. But you have to contrast that with the fact that everybody kind of knows, because they learned it at least a little bit in school, or heard about it on Brian Cox television shows or whatever. But there's some ultimate speed limit, which is the speed of light. So imagine that they had really, really good Ducati motorcycles that could go at three quarters the speed of light. And if they're going at three quarters the speed of light towards one another, it seems like if you tried to add up those numbers, well, how fast would they be moving relative to one another? The answer would be 1.5 times the speed of light. And so we obviously know that the calculation works, because when we do it at 30 kilometers per hour or 100 kilometers per hour, it works, right? There's nothing wrong with that. It really does add to 60 or 200, as the case may be. But yet somehow at 3/4 the speed of light, it doesn't work. And the answer is yes, that's right, it doesn't work, because at the slower speeds, it's really only a really, 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 really good approximation to how the laws of physics really work. And really, the relative speed when they're both going at 30 kilometers an hour is 60 minus some tiny, tiny bit. Some tiny bit that at that speed probably we couldn't possibly measure, because we couldn't get their motorcycles to be moving at precisely enough a speed close to 60, right? The speedometer's not that good. We'd have to get it to 20 decimal places to be able to check, right? But in fact, that really is only an approximation. Just so all of the Newtonian stuff, it's not a matter of believing or not believing in Newtonian physics. Newtonian physics is perfectly correct for all practical purposes most of the day, everything you do. Thank goodness for that, because most of the calculations are much easier, right? But it's not completely correct, and in fact, we know that it's not correct, because you can take out your phone and you can use GPS, right? And GPS very famously needs to take relativity into account in order to work. So we live in a world that's both Newtonian most of the time and for all practical purposes, but if we're very, very careful, then it also has to obey relativity, fourth dimensions. Okay, well, so we haven't actually put time machines on. I'll ask sort of a more actual question about time machines. Would you prefer, let's see, who shall I ask? Gus, would you prefer to go forward or backwards in time?
It's the same question I have ready for you.
Okay, good. That was an easy one, so I suspect we all thought of it.
So, I think I remember most of what happened in my life. And I'm the result of my ancestors. I have a daughter, which is like the forward-thinking aspect of my life. But I would like to go forward to see what's happening beyond entropy, beyond... No, I'd like to go forward.
Can I ask a follow-up?
Please.
What if you couldn't come back?
I try to send letters.
Fair enough.
Since Goswin can repair that question for you, perhaps you'd like to
answer
it.
Yeah, I'm looking for one.
I think I prefer to go back because I suspect that going forward would only be depressing. Not because I'm a pessimist, but because I'm a physicist. And because one of the joyous things about being a physicist is figuring things out. And if I went forward, there'd be all the stuff they figured out that I would just know. And I wouldn't have had the pleasure of kind of learning it or figuring out. It would just sort of be splashed in front of me. And there's no question it'll all be really obvious. Right? We'll see it then, you know, and I was like, oh, of course, how could we have possibly been so stupid for 1,000 years? So I think I prefer to go back.
But my question was also considering something else.
Go ahead.
Maybe I read it out as a real question. To find out what kind of time traveler you are, using some presumptions of quantum mechanics, time is like a flow of a river that can fork its path into several streams, spiral into a whirlpool, or even make a shape of a pretzel. Would you, dear Andrew, tinker with this river of time rather by sticking to one line of events and going backwards or forwards, or would you rather jump the rivers into different worlds / realities?
That's a much more complicated question. I don't know, is this the best of all possible worlds? I don't think I would trust myself to make the right decisions, you know. Going back to 1938 Munich or something, you know, killing Hitler, that's too easy, but, you know. I think I prefer to probably keep things the way they are, despite all the horrors that happen.
Because the interesting thing is that the flow of time with each event that happens might offer the possibility of a new reality. Mm-hmm. That the old one, that if I go back in time and visit my ancestors and would kill them, it would not necessarily make my present impossible. It would just be that in that string of thought, my parents would be dead. But in my reality where I came from, everything is normal. So it's like a branching out tree. So that's, for my imagination at least, it's a wonderful thought, the tree of events grows and grows.
Garden of forking paths. I mean, and this is, you know, as probably most people know, right, this is at least a plausible interpretation of the way quantum mechanics works in the world. I mean, not the time travel stuff is separate on top of that, but that every time things could have happened in some other way, and it's not entirely clear what that could have happened in some other way means, that really the universe proliferates and different things actually do happen. And we just happen to be experiencing only one of those paths in the garden.
I think I'd also like to ask Shin if he'd rather go forward or backwards in time.
Am I allowed to stay where I am? If I be able to send me back and forwards, either object or people, then I would like to do that. Good. Buildings in wrong period. Good architects but placed in wrong places. Or vice versa. Or those two people maybe should be met but hasn't met yet. They missed each other. It'd be quite wonderful. So
give us a specific example.
It's more like Photoshop.
can you give us a specific example?
Yeah, like Alfred Jarry, if we could recall him to today what's happening. Could be quite exciting.
Should you explain who he is and what that has to do with all this?
Yeah. Or even small things like, you know, recent earthquake. But then if there's right people in the right point to really act in the right way, then maybe it could have been changed as well.
You mentioned Jerry, who was the inspiration for the time machine. Would you guys like to talk about that a little at this stage?
How do we describe Jerry?
Gosh, he was a weird guy. He's a French proto-surrealist pamphleteer playwright. Wrote a pamphlet about building a time machine, which is what we did. Died of absinthe poison.
Anything you'd like to
add? Pataphysics, I suppose, yeah. Pataphysics is quite unknown things, but it's quite well known. Because there is a pataphysic association organization still active, but then I think pataphysics would be seen as kind of an impact which is created, then have been interpreted and reinterpreted, especially in the beginning of 20th century, which inherited into Dada movement, surrealist, situationist, and also lots of artwork. But I think what we thought is quite interesting is that it's actually there's an element of truth, although he's and I use lots of drugs and absence and alcoholic, and he died in the age of 37. That is really amazing. But I think those notions of kind of science or imaginary solution, which kind of how the world is being actually governed by exceptions rather than imposed rules. So, kind of those notions itself still generating lots of creative thought and mysticism as well. So in a way, but maybe I thought first of all when we begin to talk about the possible time machine and Jerry, then I thought maybe Jerry's idea can be completely dismissed by contemporary physics and so forth. But it's quite amazing, actually, that he really instinctively hitting the point of non-Euclidean geometries and relativity and so forth, which are quite
Sorry, if anyone of the instructions I hear by the prototype, if anyone wants to have a look. Shin, have you got a question for Goswin, maybe?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Again about light.
Okay.
If you are a painter, how do you paint sunlight?
Okay. I would call Anthony. So the interesting, or for me interesting thing is that he also as a photographer, you don't really photograph objects. You only photograph the light that reflects off the object, as well as its color. It's also the color of light that is reflected off the object. So everything I sometimes like try to think about that everything we see is light and not material. Some light to paint. I take a brush.
Do you look up the sun? Or is there any painter who does paint the sun? Just a question.
So, are there women
in the question?
Okay,
I'm going to
another question.
Okay, so this is something either of you can answer, but I'll ask Shin. So in your practice, in the various kinds of work that you've done, or maybe in your real life, what thing that you have or that you use is most like a time machine?
Blackberry?
Why?
Because I can be in two different places at the same time. Or I can disguise that I'm somewhere else. Also, if it's imaginary world is in here, I'll put something widely available. Probably designing this machine specific leg and follow certain things and just coordinates and construction things in terms of sequence. So currently probably most unit works we end up doing is unbuild things. So have already built things but taking things apart, then try to reverse engineering of things already been built. So in that sense, architectural practice can be seen as something related to time machines, but without actual machines being identified. That's a form of discipline, I suppose, so that you could revisit something being discussed before the theory. But at the same time, every time you think about design, you always think about what could be belong to something else in 5 years, like 10 years.
So again, I think that's quite a good question for everybody. So, Goswin, would you like to answer that question too?
Shower cubicle often leaves me afterwards feeling really refreshed and being younger. But that doesn't really last. The camera, obviously, is a machine, a mechanical instrument that allows you to record events. Revisiting the photographs, for funny reasons, you realize, or you have like an idea of when this photo was taken and how weird it seems today. Like I take a photo from 20 years ago, you start having interest, like from London or something, you start having interest of how the world looked 20 years ago. By things you recognize, that this is the street corner that I know, but look how it looked before. Like this curiosity of rediscovering your past through documents. For me, using the camera is a fantastic thing. Like photos that I discarded when I took them. Like I have contact sheets from like 10 years ago and I marked number 5, 10, 12 when I processed them 10 years ago as the important ones. I look at them today and the choice would be something completely else. My interest of looking at the old photographs is completely different to the time that I take. So for this, I'm really grateful to use the camera as a instrument that gives me a document. Like a time machine.
I'm going to answer your own question.
Sure, I guess. Okay, well, I'll use this as an opportunity to bring out my prof. And I guess, can I, audience participation, is there anybody with strong lungs? Blow this up. not a thing. It won't burst spectacularly, it'll just burst unpleasantly. So, this is a 50 to 1, so just if people here know what 50 to 1 means. Scale model, not the bit at the bottom, and not the bell jar. Wow, that was really fast. Of the Planck Surveyor satellite, and I guess this is.
Hang on.
Bravo. This is the closest thing I use on a day-to-day basis. That's a time machine. It's a camera. And it's a camera that lives a million miles from the Earth. So it's not even actually orbiting the Earth. It's further than that. And the way it works is it sort of spins around more or less this way. Around the disk. This way. And it takes a picture of what that mirror, which is the bit that is looking essentially at all of you now, right, what that sees as it spins around. And it just records a picture of what it's seeing, but it's not a camera that takes pictures of optical light. It's a camera that takes pictures of the sky in the microwave. And it turns out, for reasons that basically we got lucky, that there's very little in the universe nearby that glows in the microwave. So what it gets, when you make a picture, and so this is a picture of the whole sky. So the whole sky is a sphere. So you can imagine inverting that sphere and looking at it not as if you're looking at the outside, from the inside out, but looking at the outside in, and you get this. And so this is what the sky looks like if you had microwave eyes. And this red swath around the middle is the Milky Way. And those of you who've been lucky enough to actually ever be in a place where the sky is dark, so not London, and it's especially good in the Southern Hemisphere, look up and you see the thing that we call the Milky Way. And that's the bit you see there is gas and dust. And this is gas and dust blowing in the microwaves.
Wow.
Right? So this is nearby. This is only a few hundred thousand year old light. So practically not a time machine. But the amazing thing is that the stuff on the ends, this is light that we were talking about before, that last interacted with anything almost the whole way back to the beginning of the universe, as far as we know. So almost 13.7 billion years ago. So whereas when you take a picture with your digital camera, the light lasted something interesting, a light second away, or sorry, not even a light nanosecond away, which is a few feet. This is stuff that lasted something interesting 14 billion years ago and has been streaming towards us ever since. There are these photons are moving in all directions all over the universe, just some of them happen to be the ones that we put our detector out in front of, and we capture it, and we make this picture. So it's a much more laborious process of taking a photograph than just pointing and shooting. And that's just because it's very, very hard to make microwave cameras. If we could make microwave cameras that were that simple, we would. It's not that we particularly like having to spend a billion euros to put this thing out at L2. We'd much rather spend that on champagne. But instead, we have to spend it on this, and then just get a few cases of champagne to celebrate when it successfully gets launched. But by looking at this pattern, we see the bits that are sort of the brightest or things that turned into clusters of galaxies that we see in the universe today. Not those particular ones. We can't see those bits of the universe today anymore. That's because they're so far away now, like we said before. But if we assume that, like Copernicus taught us, that we're in a kind of boring part of the universe that's just like all the other parts of the universe, then we can assume that this is a typical slice through the universe as it, 13.7 billion years ago, and the universe is more or less like that today, statistically, and we can kind of make predictions about what it should be like from looking at this. So we can go from the past to the present and then actually begin to make predictions about the future.
Goswin, would you like to ask the next question?
Yes. So, this is a question for you. Dear Andrew, does the observer, as explained in quantum mechanics, and that is something that bugs my mind. Also, as a photographer, I might be able to explain this later, has an influence on the observer. And what does that do ultimately to our trust in science and its claim for unbiased source of information and explanation?
Okay. So yes, but not in a metaphorical way, in a very precise mathematical way. So if we have a small particle, an atom in a box, and we attempt to observe it, there's a limit to how well we can observe its location and its speed. Right? And that limit is because the act of observation actually moves it around. In order to observe something, you have to do something like bounce a photon. So that's a tiny effect that we could precisely characterize. If I'm wandering around outside and I sneak a peek around the corner and I look and see something happening there, that has nothing to do with that, right? I'm just observing something going on. There's almost no interaction at that level. It would have almost no effect. So it doesn't. This has no problem with scientific objectivity, because this is a very mathematically precise and very, very tiny effect. But of course, the way we use this in the world is we use it as a metaphor. Right?
Yeah, but there's also this double slit experiment where not only photons but also matter particles go through like two slits and don't hit the opposite wall, and also with the shadow of two slits, but in terms of waves. That means that they go through the two slits either way. And when they're observed, I heard, they follow the two slits projection.
Well, if you check which one they're going through as they go through, then you can be sure which one they went through so they don't interfere indeed. So that does happen. But if you do the experiment with tennis balls, then you can see, then you always see where they're going through. So the observation of the tennis ball is not a problem. Right? So it's only because we're talking about this tiny, tiny realm of these very, very light, very, very small particles that this has an effect. But indeed, this stuff does happen, and it's vastly weird.
There's a question.
I'm fascinated because I've seen not long ago the film Cave of Forgotten Dreams. I don't know if any of you have seen it, but it's basically Werner Herzog taking a team of very eccentric experts into some cave drawings that were done 30,000 years ago and have been sealed since then. And one of the things that he reports is that the crew actually felt watched as they were in the caves, watching this sort of form of what he calls proto-cinema that was being made of very elaborate drawings at the same time that Neanderthal man was out there. And I think a lot of the questions you're talking about are about science, but to me they beg a lot of questions about art and the sort of historical drawings that are found in caves. I wondered, in terms of your design background, if anyone of you had thought about this and what your reactions were, because that seems to me to be on a line with sort of quantum physics, architecture, time travel, and those kinds of concepts. But I don't have a scientific formula for how. I'm just interested in your reactions.
Yeah, but I sometimes think about it, like when if it's the postulate can be translated, the quantum mechanic postulate, that things change when they're observed. In photography, for example, war photographers really change the event. And if we don't get the photographic evidence of what happens around the world, often they're not really regarded or taken into consideration, and no action against some potential cruel actions are being taken. So in that sense, like, I regard also photography as something that can change the observed. Maybe not as a immediately, but as a result of the medium.
Probably discipline architects always follow the form of representation. It varies because every time new technology or way of looking at this comes out available. And I think architect is one of the disciplines which either borrow, usually second hand. So what kind of unseen world can be recognized, but same time to use it as a form of design process. So in that sense, probably design, there is no clear discipline like photographer and camera and photograph. But I think the notions of how to visualize unseen or something become more complex, so that what is actually how the world works. At some point you are somehow trained to be, at least pretend to be in control of it. So creating your own context and drawing some data in which you believe you can change it. But I think that's a difficulty because if the architectural practice just purely reflect what's around our world to show us what, how it works, then probably design can be far more creative. But somehow, sometimes, kind of you believe that you can make something better or something good, then that's become very adding some frustrating aspects to design discipline, I suppose. So I'm not sure I'm answering this so no, but somehow idea of the medias and how the world being presented, which are actually sometimes too easy to grasp and just show without really questioning where they really come from or what the real ideas behind it. Because a huge amount of disciplines and knowledge went into those productions. But on the other hand, speed of constructing cities or architecture is far faster than the recognizing all those layers of knowledge and sensitivities and culture background. So, I think that's one of the aspects which might be quite interesting things we saw is that the you see these objects from satellite, then this is our answer to this. Yeah. The principle is the same, but then we deliberately using wrong materials and wrong technology and wrong discipline, but deliberately pull things together. So it's actually Planck satellite as model, then as soon as we look at this model, then we think we get it. But it's actually layers and layers of knowledge and technology, which including how to send the satellite to orbit and how to work or how the communication really works for us to actually see it. Then these must be just simple representation of demonstration of how things really works. So I think something architectural practice sometimes I feel it's too fast. But on the other hand, world changing very, very fast as well. So,
Hey, are there more questions from each other or should we open up to the floor? Okay,
like Andrew, like one here, Andrew again, yes? there's a quote in physics that says everything that is not forbidden is compulsory. Does this allow in your eyes for time travel?
Well, there are plenty of things that are forbidden. The weasel answer is I don't know. It doesn't appear to be forbidden by general relativity, which is our theory of gravity and things moving high speeds and large masses. In fact, more to the point, it's explicitly a solution of Einstein's equations in certain cases, which you could imagine it being physically possible to build. But I was quite careful to say you can imagine, because we don't know. It's possible that, in fact, my money would be on it's actually not possible. And only because Einstein's equations are some approximation to the real theory, and in that real theory, it's impossible. And that's because it's very difficult to get away from contradictions and killing your grandfather type things. It would mean that it's possible for there to be essentially undecidable bits of the universe where you just couldn't make any predictions. And it's not clear why those shouldn't be everywhere. And we know they're not everywhere because we're perfectly good at making predictions about most of the universe that we see. In fact, all of the universe that we see as far as we can tell. So probably not, but hopefully, because it would be really fun.
Yeah. Because I read Stephen Hawking saying time travel is very highly unlikely and very impractical.
Yeah.
Which I thought was like a nice way.
Yeah, the ideas that we do have would be technologically so far beyond what we can imagine that it's hard to think of the way you do it.
Mm. So that leaves like some chance of some later generations to go.
Sure. But where are they? Well, which of you are a time traveler, right? I mean, okay, not here, this is boring, but they haven't come back as far as we know.
Do you have any further questions?
In some of your teaching it's come up, so has time travel kind of explicitly informed any of the stuff you've done? Not real time travel, but, you know, as fiction or as a metaphor or something like that. Aside from this, I guess.
No.
You can tell we didn't prepare.
I think we always do that, no? But if you're there, if you don't do anything on this site, what do you think is going to happen in 20 years' time? Then you create context. So we all do that. In terms of really science fiction based things,
yeah.
Just designing something, it's what I think your site is like 500 years ahead. Imagine, but there are some units doing that, so speculating what technology can be available. In that sense, strangely, I noticed lots of reference to 1970s, lots of architectural projects for urban research. They are actually imaginative period, even before internet is widely available, or holographic grids, or some other technology, which are all their dreams in 1970s. Then make some project based upon those technologies not being available. Right. Quite interesting things to revisit those projects to look at what that happened about that project. Ideas can be, actually sometimes idea comes first and technology become available later. So, since we could use lots of reference, actually never wrote any brief based upon time travel. But you do that, no? In the photograph, you set up some. I remember your course, you know, booking one hotel room in my hotel.
Yes,
that's one. Fabricate some event and take one particular photograph, which be described history or event never happened before, but it's just communicated with possibility. So.
Yeah, we have even Alex here who attempted to calculate or to imagine a camera that becomes able to shoot photos into the past and how it would work. So he came up with an equation that the shutter speed should be faster than 1 over the speed of light.
Can I ask, because the globe has the light that's escaped. I mean, my project was with Goswin, and imagining if you could be at one of those points looking back at the light that's escaped a certain scene, and if you were to have a camera to capture that light, would you capture that scene that's 10 billion years old, or would you, what would you capture?
If you were there then?
If you were,
when that light is the way it was 13 billion years ago, it's not the way it is now.
So you capture the event from back then?
But I mean, I see this bottle of water,
yeah,
the light's reflecting.
Yeah, but that, but the, it's the light reflecting off it as it was a tiny, tiny, tiny fraction of a second before
now. Yeah.
So that's old light that that's a picture of.
Everything we see is old.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you were there then, the universe then was only 400,000 years old.
Well, I mean, this lady behind me sees an older version of,
yeah,
of the hot water.
Yeah.
So if you were to be at the edge of your globe, you would see the same bottle of water, but
if you were there, if you were there today,
yeah.
So, or if you were there in a few billion years, so right. So it's a different geometry. So, but you can certainly keep moving further and further away from any event now. And if you can move at the speed of light, then you know you'll. If you when you look back, you'll just be seeing the light as it is now. So you can certainly do that.
But light you see will be different from the light some little thing behind you too.
I mean, if the interesting thing is if you're at the place that those splotches turned into today, and you had a doppelganger of this there, as the aliens there might do, then you'd be seeing the thing that the Earth was 14 billion years ago. So it's red splotch in the universe then. You wouldn't be able to tell that it turned into the Earth. It would just look like all the other red splotches.
Shin Egashira have any more questions? Maybe a final one before we go to the floor before we go.
Yeah, one for Shin. The last one.
Yep.
I have made an equation. Metaphysics minus physics equals question mark artistic slash poetic expression. Looking at your work, especially of the one of the impossible vehicle that I only discovered today, and taking the possibility of the impossible into consideration, would you, dear Shin, elaborate on your visualization of space-time manipulation as a poetic reflection of the involved mechanics? Yeah. No, the beautiful machine of the impossible vehicle that I only discovered today, a few light years after it was created, has a beautiful representation of mechanics and also represent, as far as I understood, a clock that draws space and the spatial observer, the observer of it, into a spatial context. Do you use the impossibility of deducting or differentiating between space and time, or to extrude time out of space, or the other way around, as a component in your installation? Does that make same?
Kind of. First of all, explain the intention of this.
Yeah, maybe.
Vehicle, which is
the story.
Remember exactly, it's very old project. I thought in some point it's really more important to something really, really simple, which enable to reflect other form of reality. So clock is basically that project is gathering all the discarded objects from London. So I just traveling around and every skip some pieces and just accumulate for a year. Then selecting from part by part. So then hopefully it's gonna become something. But all idea is whatever is giving some places has to be performed absolutely uselessly. So things doesn't make sense, something doesn't fit. All those unbalance and mechanism which usually not being connected. Then at the end try to make some machine which doesn't produce anything. Mm-hmm. Just constantly rotating slowly so that it irritates people and disturbing how people move and disappear in certain time. So that is the idea. Then realizing that, well, it's actually, it's any machine we notice has actually proper function. Then realizing that any machines produce is just outcome. Either perform excess or unnecessary or reinterpretation. Because some machines not related upon intention of the machine has been presented by its context, its function. So in a way, in order to avoid that any machines become part of the vicious cycle of the machine, only things to appreciate those poetics is to avoid any form of functionality. Just simply does a certain job. That's what I'm explaining clearly, no? So, there's some ideas about poetics or space or whatever it is, which maybe is how to disconnect from any association from surrounding. At the same time using a very familiar language of like wheels or something spins or something or something.
So you think this equation could make sense in your case?
Take physics from metaphysics?
No, the other way. Metaphysics is more than physics. Mm. So you didact the physics and you receive like an artistic expression, poetic expression.
I think that's part of the reason it's kind of very drawn into metaphysics. Metaphysics is physics beyond the metaphysics. Mm-hmm. So it goes beyond it.
So beyond?
Beyond, yeah.
Beyond what?
Beyond the metaphysics.
So it's beyond physics. Like meta means beyond.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Then pata is beyond the meta.
Okay, are there any more questions from the floor? It's probably easier for you to pass. That's
all right.
Okay.
I'd be interested Andrew's perception you'd be familiar with Roger Penrose, Professor Penrose, one of your colleagues in the same field, has a theory of cosmic cycles, all of cosmic cycles. Without going into details, but my understanding is that it's space-time representation that uses something that I consider to be analogous to the spectrum to, if you like, pull down infinities into something that is finite and represent just as a literature of the horizon zones, which was not a new technique. My understanding also is that this theory, prior to the Big Bang of 13 billion years ago, we were from the previous universe and one before that, and what's more, certain big events in those, like big holes, black holes bang into each other, into oblivion, produce ripples which indeed pass through from the previous universe into this universe, and that those ripples show up in the cosmic background radiation you're observing. And actually, now they're not able to see those apparent rings in the sky, very faintly. It seemed to me, or perhaps you'd like to view this picture of conformal geometry as a possible medium for the artistic world to take something, because it's got a space-time by definition, which is a time element, or being projected either within this universe or previous ones as a technique, just the concepts around where angles are maintained, but scaling of size becomes less important. Do you believe there's any scope for welding those two ideas together?
Gosh, I'm not entirely sure what the question was, but I'll riff on it and you can stop me at any point. So there's a technical question of Penrose's theories of the universe, which I think are probably false. And certainly his technical results later, the last 6 months or so, are just wrong.
Oh,
he's a very, very smart guy. His theory may still be right, but the observations do not show that his theory is right because he's wrong in the interpretation. But I think that the other bit that you brought up is more interesting, right? Which is whether there's any interest in taking some of the technical bits of this theory and kind of using them entirely in unrelated ways in other media. And you know, there's certainly a long and occasionally interesting history of artists taking ideas from science and using them in various ways. I mean, perspective in some sense is exactly that. And this is sort of an altered perspective. So I think there's no problem with people just taking that and running with it. It doesn't mean that they've learned anything about the universe by doing that, aside from the fact the way that any art teaches us something about the way we observe the universe, and the way that any use of science as a metaphor in art can be good or bad and may or may not, at the end of the day, have anything to do with the science, but if it produces interesting and good art, that's what I think to me.
I'm going to be pretty vague, but when one talks about the distancy of an observed event and one says the universe is, one should say the universe was or the universe might be. Because if we say something is also something it is not. And then we see it from a human perspective, and when we talk about machinery, we talk about something we conceive as human. But I think if the universe acts upon tendencies that we try to approach, these tendencies are open beyond us. So I'm sure that if supernovas exist, or possibly big bangs and black holes, time travel exists, I think. It's not a question. You can fight against it.
I have another question, actually. It might be related. I'm sure we know long enough to allow me to ask this question. Do you believe in God?
No.
Do you sometimes get scared by dealing with large numbers and extreme measurements when you really try to visualize them?
Scared may be too strong a word, but...
Well, existentially challenged.
It doesn't take big numbers to make me existentially challenged. I guess so. There's one... If the universe is really infinite, then I find it all extremely puzzling. That's not a strong enough word. But scared isn't the right word either.
No, not scared.
Because if the universe is infinitely large and quantum mechanics is right, you know, sort of all possible things kind of pop off at all times, then literally everything that's possible is happening somewhere at some point. And, you know, so there's this room, you know, without me, which is very strange for you guys, right? Not so much me because I'm not here. But there's this room where this is over here, right? And that, you know, and then there's all the ones where it's just, it's even more weird. And I find that, yeah, infinities are complicated. So the upshot of that is most physicists probably think that infinities don't exist at the end of the day. There's nothing really infinitely small or infinitely large. But then you have all these other problems, like why is there only a finite amount of stuff, which is also hard.
But Planck, I found this. Planck apparently said, science cannot solve the ultimate mystery of nature. Because ourselves, we are part of the mystery we are trying to solve. Does that touch the problem we have with imagining infinity?
Maybe. I don't know, what's the ultimate mystery of nature? That's just a label. Ask me a question and I can try to answer. Ask questions. The old, you know, 42.
Yeah, we could walk on religious ground at some stage.
No, but that just fobs it off onto some ultimate being, right? So that doesn't really help.
But there's also this question about consciousness and consciousness of material in physics at a very stretched stage of physics, probably. A good person to produce time travel effects is for me undoubtedly David Lynch, who himself is a strong believer of quantum physics and uses quantum physics also to explain some part of his practice of transcendental meditation, where he enters the unified field, where he thinks like there he collects uncensored universal knowledge. And he has, for his foundation of transcendental meditation, apparently doctorate people working for him that come from quantum science, quantum mechanics. And there I think it's a provocative thought maybe, and maybe one that is not so often addressed in an academic context, but maybe in an artistic context. That's why maybe you posed the question, do you believe in God? There comes a stage when we go smaller and smaller and smaller and look at what really happens, or what could happen, or what is not happening and why, then we could confront this ultimate mystery of nature. I don't know. Don't you think so? Oh. I'm not much older, but I don't know.
But I think the reason I asked about the God things is because only things is I try to put myself in other shoes and try to imagine what kind of time scale, at least a certain time of the day or certain days of the week, you engage with some kind of huge time scale. Earth is about 4 billion like years old.
Just years,
so
right?
So in a way, light you feeling to be connected is far before even Earth is being created. So how is it like to recognize your connections to such long abstract period of time, then you are actually experiencing it. So that is beyond my imagination, or I don't have that capacity to locate myself in direction to one. So that is really amazing. It's really as strange as reading the Jarry's text or any other form of art. So, yes, I mean, then most of the people might be worried that, well, this world is so big, and worried that the world might be too small or whatever, then maybe you borrow some notions of either origins or the poems. So I'm very glad that you say you're really important.
Okay, there was another question.
To go back to this infinity issue, I was thinking, so basically the universe is infinite, right? Then that would practically render the time machine completely useless, in a sense. Or it would at least change it completely, right? Because that would cover also the possibility that somewhere in the universe, you know, like the next second is there as well. And the next second after that is there as well. Am I wrong in presuming that? And not only that, but all other impossible situations that are not consistent with our, let's say, vision, future,
right,
would be that.
Right. So they have to be consistent with the laws of physics. It's not that everything happens. It's that everything. It's exactly what you said. Everything that isn't forbidden happens. But there are plenty of things that are forbidden.
So who locks the chronology protection? Like there's a the chronology is protected.
Well, we don't know. I mean, maybe time machines really are possible, and then.
No, it's locked. The chronology, you cannot take it apart.
But not if what you said about splitting the universe into different paths, right? That would be a way to not protect the chronology. So you can build, I don't know, consistent, but at least, you know, not entirely ridiculously implausible pictures of the universe where either you can't go back and kill your grandfather because you didn't, so it didn't happen. But that's, you know, if time machine is possible, that's really weird. Then free will is weird because you think you can, but you can't. But there's plenty of things that I think I can do that I can't. I mean, I would think, so maybe I thought I could walk through this table, but I can't. But maybe it partitions into the Garden of Working Paths, and there's the you that kills your grandfather, and you just don't exist in that universe. Who knows?
Yeah, it's really interesting to listen to this, especially after like time traveling turned out to be more political than anyone thought after China 2 weeks ago banned time traveling films for the first time as a country banned on time travel films. So everything from La Jetée until now has been banned, and any sequence that shows time travel is banned because it's been said that it's an escape from the present. That's just a thought. But my question basically is, you were speaking about scientific objectivity and art as well, and like last week the new Terrence Malick film, The Tree of Life, premiered, and it has 20-30 minutes, I don't know how much, of shots that are supposedly the most scientifically accurate shots of the creation of the cosmos, and they were the first shots that were created from beginning to end in 4 years with NASA. And I mean, thinkers like Bruno Latour have been writing about this for a couple of years now. What do you think of this? Why now the combination of scientific objectivity as art? And wanted to ask you if that's an aesthetic that you are interested in, the digital post-production, and if you are interested in scientific accuracy in aesthetics.
Say it again, thank
you. Are you interested in scientific accuracy in aesthetics? You are interested in following that path in photography and post-production and rendering digital landscapes that are scientifically accurate, and that bridge between aesthetics and scientific objectivity.
So, scientific accuracy and objectivity are good goals. But like architecture and photography and art, it's a practice done by human beings. And human beings are notoriously terrible at objectivity. Good, that's fine most of the time. And I think even, so there's a lot of non-objectivity in science, even if the results of science are objective in the sense that you choose what to work on. So there's plenty of science that isn't getting done because nobody wants to do it. There's plenty of science that's being done because of bandwagons and funding and things like that. Not particularly interesting reason to do science, but it's hard to not make a living. And I would guess that in actually, it's funny, because I actually have a lengthy quote about malice duty, which I was also thinking about. I haven't seen it. Because somebody reviewed it and actually used the word conceptual time travel. Not the very beginning scene you're talking about. But I would guess that a lot of aesthetic choices were made in exactly how to present that. So it's not just, there isn't a way to present the first 14 billion years of the universe that NASA tells you, and that's the only right way to do it. You have to make lots of choices, and Terrence Malick is a really good filmmaker, so he must have made visual choices that have nothing to do with what NASA gave him in some bits on some box. And we do that too as scientists, right? We want to present, we are objective, but we're arguing for our version of things. And so we have to present papers that people not only read and understand, but believe. And we have to produce plots in our papers that people can understand and get something out of. And we're not above trying to present things our way as opposed to just in some completely dry, descriptive way, even if we think we are. But what about the use of science, supposed objectivity in artistic practice?
In photography, we really live or have to live with the fact that industrial or digital evolution is so fast that renders material like the hardware so old, so quick, that you start to look backwards, and I start to look backwards and try to cultivate the original photographic mechanics and involve them in a contemporary or in a today way, like. And because, as I said before, with analog way of working, you retain a physical evidence of where you have been at what time through your negative or through the Polaroid or through the positive you take from that camera that was in that camera at the time of the event. Whereas pixels down on the camera back are much more, much less physical evidence of that. And for me, this, and I can only speak for myself, for me, I somehow need this anchor of a feeling that holds me in the race of today's scientific evolution. Also, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. There's a question.
One more question, actually, from Shin. It was this impossible machine was fascinating, but it kind of raised some more questions for me. Like, is it, if you see the impossible machine as an object or something, is it actually possible to come up with the impossible machine? Because when you were talking about it, you were exemplifying poetry as something that basically doesn't represent the context. But I think also poetry presents a context as well for just a different purpose. So it's also a machine, but for a different purpose. So if a machine doesn't represent a context, what does it become? And, you know, does it become another type of machine? Or, you know, is there anything actually, does anything exist that doesn't represent a context?
Yeah, that's why it's impossibilities, I suppose,
as a machine.
Not really clearly understanding.
Well, it's actually got me thinking, because when you exemplified poetry as something that is non-contextual in a way, I was thinking about, you know, like started thinking about poetry is like done by mathematicians and physicists who are actually representing something, and then I thought about the other ones that are actually like sometimes social, sometimes about love, sometimes about so many other things, that they are also kind of like a machine but presenting a different context. It's I ended up like quite actually confused so about this whole. So I haven't seen that project of Impossible Machine. I don't know what's the result of the study of an impossible machine, but
I think it's as a personal level of practice. Of course, each project has certain ways and also take form of installation. So when those are done, then normally nobody buys those things, so just finding my garage. It's quite sad. Yeah, but I think there is a series of, for example, one big pinhole camera created this kind of impossible duration of the time to capture and make very big print. It is actually really, really impossible, but in fact, what I need is really fractions of scientific knowledge. Just give some really impossible task to perform to stretch those limits. No matter how beautiful or how ugly or how difficult it is, but it's on its own work. So, of course, I think I didn't explain the idea of poetry, but for me, poetry is only pure description of things. So you are not explaining how beautiful things are or how important this versus the other. So I find some of the scientific equations find really poetic. It's really precise. Just no clear hierarchy, but just describe things in relation to one another. So probably those installation objects, it's without using numbers or words or descriptions as writing or songs. Pictures, simply collected objects, place. Then reading it might be up to situations or places. So that's just what I'm explaining for you.
Okay. Stefano, do you have a question for them?
No, no question.
Okay, I have one final question that I wanted to ask, which was, If sort of entropy is the final state of the universe, and if we're going to go and have the death and be in entropy, is there time beyond entropy?
It's just really boring. time marches on, it's just, we'll be around to care.
What
are
my
questions?
You two, or maybe include myself. If you describe, if you explain what is entropy to, let's say, 5 years old, how do you explain it? Or Stefano can
answer. Once I answer them, people don't want to take a step, so it's more fun to people.
Thank you.
What is the entropy? The entropy is the level of disorder that is ever growing. Yeah. But for me, can I tell you something? Because the research has been going on for 3 years now. And the three themes were energy, entropy, and form. And I think that entropy, in a way, is the easiest concept to grasp, that everything passed from order to disorder. Then there is the notion of form, which is relatively clear. And then there is the notion of energy, which is definitely the most unclear one. And what is striking for me is that even today, when you really look for a definition of energy, it is the possibility of something to do some work. But we don't know what is the something, and we don't know what is work. The only thing that we know is that one quality of energy is always constant. It's the principle of conservation of energy. And I think that for me this is quite striking, because in a way it solves a lot of ideas that we generally have, including the one of time. That's why, in a way, as well as this thing of space, what is really space and what is time? And in a way, there are things that you cannot define, but you just know the quality of it. Mm-hmm. And that's why, for me, the question of space immediately relates to the notion of energy.
So the one simplest example I was explained before, if you have a pile of salt and a pile of sugar, and you just mix them, stir them, then it's very, very easy to mix them, but it's almost impossible to separate them. So the amount of energy you spend for mixing is like nothing compared to how to separate. So that is kind of minus energy.
And I thought when you explain, you are searching for only interesting light, which is 130 billion light years away. You have so many light information coming through your satellite. Then you're filtering out and sorting which ones is actually information, which ones you decided to discard. And I thought it's quite interesting, it's a beautiful kind of image I create and you're analyzing it. It's like, yeah, this light is not. But in a way, photograph, the way you really construct and frame, sure there is more energy spent to illuminating information for excess of things to really sorting. And I find that this is quite interesting, this leader. And then I wish I can do that too.
Okay, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much.